kids, Pete from 8-Bit Central here, and I thought we'd have a chat about the future of retro gaming. Now, retro gaming is obviously kind of steeped in the past, but as time moves forward, retro gaming does indeed have a future. But that future, as I had sort of always perceived it, you know, cartridges and game carts and all that good stuff, kind of changed around 95 when Sony brought out the original PlayStation. All of a sudden, that for me was kind of a game changer in terms of how I looked at retro gaming and what's going to happen to it in the future. Now, as we look at that, I'd also like to use an analogy, because I'm a big fan of analogies. They kind of drive a point home. So, I'm a big fan of classic cars. Muscle cars from the 60s, 70s. Just love that era of cars. They're just so badass. And that, too, moving forward, you start to see a shift in the types of cars and the restorations done. And it kind of leaves me with the same kind of a feeling of, what's the future of something like that? So let's compare the two, have a quick look at some badass cars, some kick-ass gaming. Stay tuned. So my childhood full of gaming wonders really started with the Atari 2600 and progressed through the line. I absolutely adore the 7800 because it plays all my 2600 games. Now, for the purposes of our discussion in the future of retro gaming, I'd mentioned that the original PlayStation really is the one that kind of changed my perception of things. Now, you may be saying to yourself, but gee, isn't this a PS2 that you've got sitting here? And indeed it is. And the reason for that is twofold. One, because I grew up on the 2600, and then when the 7800 came out, it offered superior graphics and so forth that we'd been accustomed to on the 5200, but gave us the compatibility with the 2600. And likewise, with the PS2, when it came out, it actually played PS1 games, the original PlayStation games. And that was just awesome, because unfortunately, my original PlayStation is no longer with us. I still have it, it just doesn't work. And the reason I really got into the PS2 was really, at that point, I didn't really care about it. But when I came across things like, you know, Williams Arcade's Greatest Hits for the PS1, and suddenly not being able to play Defender, Joust, Robotron, all those titles on there, that was unacceptable. So I got a PS2, which is PS1 compatible. Now, truth be told, for the purposes of this video, I have no idea where my PS1 is. It doesn't work, it's broken, I still have it, I have fond memories of it, just don't know where it is. So I got a PS2 out here. But let's look at why I really think the PS2 is very significant. Okay, I meant PS1, or the original, because... Well, now I'm just screwing up the whole thing. This has just set me off kilter now. I'm going home. I quit. The differences between these consoles is, primarily, when the PlayStation came out, I was so stoked because it was disc-based. I mean, think about the storage capacity. I mean, these carts, you know, the 2600, they were futzing around with 4K of memory. The 7800 was, I don't know, maybe a little bit more? Not real technical in those aspects of things, but... I was familiar with CDs, DVDs, and that whole sort of thing, and I know you can put a billion more things onto an optical disc than you could a standard cartridge. And that just seemed to really open up the entire realm of what can you display on my TV screen that I can interact with as a game. But the other thing that this brought to us was something that many of us computer users who, you know, back in the day had CD drives and so forth. Moving parts are the enemy of pretty much anything. Now, when you look at like these old cartridge-based systems, when you think about moving parts, you're really talking about like an on-off switch or the TV selector switch, because you know sometimes channel 3 didn't work quite the way channel 4 did, and you had to have that little switch. But when you have a disc mechanism, I mean, this thing is spinning. And that is like brutal wear and tear compared to these systems. I mean, this is my original VCS from when I was 12. Still works like a charm. Haven't broken any of the buttons, but you know, in terms of moving parts, even if I were to break a switch, I could always pop the shell off here and find some way to make that connection and get it to work. These things are pretty robust. When we talk about disc-based systems, not so much. Something that's spinning all the time like that, it's going to heat up, and it is going to fail eventually. So, when I think about retro gaming and just the wonders of dragging out my original 2600 and playing a game on it, let's go ahead 30 years, and what do you think is going to happen to this PS2 that's wonderfully PS1 compatible, unlike the PS3 or the PS4, apparently? No backwards compatibility? The hell? But what's going to happen with this? I mean, I have ROMs for virtually every game out there. I much prefer the actual hardware. But when we talk about PlayStation, or any of these newer systems that are all disc-based now, the mechanisms in there are gonna fail. And, you know, down the road, say 20 years from now, 30 years from now, what are we gonna be playing? Because you're probably not gonna have a functional PlayStation of any sort. That's going to play the old game, certainly. You're not going to have anything to play a PS1. So does that shift retro gaming 20, 30 years from now into the realm of ROMs being computer-based and really sort of leaving this hardware that we adored behind? It's kind of hard to say. But the analogy I really want to make has to do with muscle cars. Because like I grew up with the Atari, I also grew up in the era when cars were just badass looking. No electrics, no hybrids, and nothing from VW that really looks like a big smiley face when you look at it from the front. When you saw like a Dodge Charger or something coming at you, it looked pretty fierce. I mean, it was cool, but when it got really close, you almost wanted to jump out of the way because it had this kind of sinister look to it. That's just pretty cool. Now cars are just like, hey! Just like Disney cars, almost. Now, I really like what they've done with the new Dodge Charger. That's a pretty kick-ass looking car. Not quite the same as the older model from my youth, but they've done a nice job in sort of bringing that sort of sense and feeling to it into today's world. That's pretty cool. But think about today's cars. Cars that are on the road today, something that you might have bought in the last 2-3 years or so forth. And let's do the same thing we did with the retro gaming. Let's, you know, go forward 20-30 years. How many cool, like, 69 Camaros do you think are going to be running strong in 30 years? 30 years, how easy is it going to be to find one to restore? What are we going to be doing in 30 years car-wise? Is someone going to be, like, uber stoked to fix up and bring to full life a Ford Fiesta? I mean, what are we going to do? It needs a little bit of body work. So you're going to get out a hairdryer and do the body work because cars today are all made of plastic. The cars from back in my youth, they use this thing called metal. But just sort of think about the way, when you progress with that, what's going to happen to that? I mean, what car now? I mean, maybe like a Mustang or something like that. You know, it's entirely possible that those will be around. That'll sort of become the new muscle car of 2040 or what have you. But the cars that we think of as muscle cars now, where are they going to be? And is there going to be sort of a phase shift in terms of the way people restore cars, in terms of what cars can be restored and what are they going to do to them? But I think it's very similar to retro gaming in the sense that these disc-based machines aren't really going to perform 20, 30 years. So what does that do to retro gaming? It might all go to ROMs. So we're going to be out in the yard, working on our car, getting that Fiesta looking real good, hitting it with the hairdryer to get that little dent out. Oh yeah! Working with plastics. But when we're done with that, we might crack open a beer, go in the house, relax, fire up the computer, and play some our favorite old PS1, PS2, PS3 games via ROM in an emulator in a window on our computer screen. Now, in 20, 30 years, maybe our computer screen is actually not going to be a screen. Maybe it's just going to be some sort of projection up on a wall that's like 9 feet across, and that's going to be pretty cool. And certainly, but that sort of retro feel of, you know, jumping into a 69 Camaro. Buddy of mine in high school had the Trans Am that had the eagle on the hood, jet black, golden eagle on the hood, and wow, that was the coolest thing ever. Now, you know, I drive a car to work every day, gets me there, does the job, that's cool. But like retro gaming, you know, I can play any Atari game or Nintendo game via emulator, but isn't it a lot more fun to get out a 2600 or 7800 or the NES, put that card in, realize it doesn't work, clean the contacts, blow on it, do all those cool things, and get it working, and have that joystick in your hand? That's the real thing. But it kind of brings back that whole feeling, you know? There's nothing like sitting on the floor in front of the TV and playing an old video game that you loved from childhood. And I'm sure when 20, 30 years passes, I'm still going to want to get into a bitchin' Camaro. But it's going to be pretty difficult to do in that time frame. I might be getting into a bitchin' Fiesta. I don't know. Keep it retro. Keep thinking. Keep gaming.